Welcome to the Experience Podcast. I'm your co-host, CCN, the girl who pops gum in class way too loud.
And I'm Jayla, your other co-host, the girl that you think is whitewashed, but you really have no idea.
Yikes. Anyways, y'all,
this is the Experience Podcast.
The Experience Podcast.
Prepare to get juicy.
So prepare to get experienced.
Right.
So as you can see by our title, the first episode is about the Black girl experience. So let's jump into it. So first on the agenda is stereotypes. We're going to be talking about the stereotypes of Black girls face and how that feeds into our everyday life as Black girls. So let's start.
Well, as you've seen in our introduction, what I've been stereotyped as is whitewashed. This is because I think it's because I'm a little articulate, maybe.
Articulate, wow.
I sit with my legs crossed, you know?
So do most people?
Yeah, I don't know where it comes from, really. I'm trying to, like, think of why. Maybe it's, like, maybe it's the bag.
I don't know. Bag.
I don't know what it is, but I'm not whitewashed. But it is a very common stereotype for a lot of Black girls that I know they go through.
The stereotypes that I'm mostly familiar with, well, yeah, the whitewash part, but, like, also the being loud and ghetto, that, like, stereotype, I feel like is really detrimental to Black girls because, like, at such a young age, you just see that as being, like, that's supposed to be your whole personality. Mm-hmm. And it's like, well, I'm a little kid.
Right.
Or it doesn't even matter if you're a little kid. It just transforms from little kid to adolescent to, like, as you get older, and it's just like, I'm just supposed to be loud. But in moments, you want to be vulnerable. Like, you don't want to only be seen as loud or ghetto and stuff like that. And it's just like, I'm also not that. I'm right. Also a human being.
I think it is pretty hard, especially since, like, that's one of our only forms of representation that we get. And it's just really crazy how people feed into it. Like, yeah. That is a lot of girls' complete whole persona. Like, they're just like, I'm not going to do the impression, but they're very,
like, that whole Hot Cheeto trend, that mm-hmm. whole Hot Cheeto Girl trend, I mean, on, like, TikTok and stuff, it was like, oh my gosh, I used to be a Hot Cheeto Girl, which, for those who don't know, it was basically girls who would eat Hot Cheetos, like, at 7 a.m. in the morning at school and wear big hoop earrings and have their edges done with a whole bunch of lip gloss and, like,
super long acrylic nails that, like, used to clack when they spoke.
And the thing is, like, that was, like, what Black girls were painted as, and some Black girls were dressed, like, quote-unquote, dressed up like that. And then white girls, and also Hispanic girls, too, but, like, some white girls would, like, do that as well, and it was just, like, oh, they're just in a Hot Cheeto Girl, like, mood. It was just, like, an aesthetic, like, a costume for them. And then they would talk about, like, on TikTok, like, oh, I used to be a Hot Cheeto Girl, but I'm, like, out of that phase now. So, basically, you're saying, like, oh, I used to be a Black girl, but now, like, I'm not, like, I'm back yeah. to my whiteness, like, it's fine. And
it's like, it's a lot of things that are, like, Black girl personas that are used as trends, yeah. but it's a mockery. Yeah. Like, what's that song? Period.
Oh, yeah, that period. Like,
it's not funny.
It's not funny. I don't know how she's getting, like, anything, like, any monetization from it. But it's just, like, she's mocking Black girls by doing that. Like, that whole...
Blatantly.
And it just goes into, like, I guess hair. That was, like, our next conversation. But, like, hair in the Black community, especially for Black women, the stereotypes for that is just, like, crazy. Just, like, breaking combs, breaking combs and brushes. Like, that, I remember in elementary school, that used to be a whole thing, like, oh, I bet you broke, like, 20 combs or something, or in Life's Day, they would, like, not even go through my hair. When I would go to my friend's house, they would not even, like, do anything with my hair, but they would do everything with their friend's hair. They'd be like, oh, let's do this or that, mm-hmm. and, like, I was never included in that, and that's why I feel like education is really important to, like, equal education, so everybody sees everybody's experience, because, like, this is where stereotypes come from, is the lack of education that people are getting.
Right. And, you know, I went through a phase in middle school where I had a perm, and I did get a lot of, oh, she must hate herself. Oh, she must not appreciate. I had a lot of teachers tell me, like, you gotta love your black. It's like, Girl, I love my black. I just don't have the time in the mornings. Right. It's just not really just giving, you know, like, raking through it for an hour, deep condition. Ooh. She's on. Don't worry, y'all. Raking through it, deep condition. It's not. It's a very long process. And then the products are so expensive. And so I had a perm, and people did not like that at all.
Right. Another thing about products is that literally if you go to any, like, CVS, Walgreens, or if you go to the beauty supply store, they literally locked up half of the products for black girls. But not even just girls. For black people. Like, you still have to ring the little bell, have the worker come, open it up, ask them which one you want, and then they'll take it for you and bring it to the counter, and then they'll watch you pay. And it's like, you guys are criminalizing black people so much. You don't think we could buy our own hair products?
Literally. It's because they're so expensive.
They're like $8 yeah, like just for a nice curl.
Is $4. Like, you can get a bottle of Pantene shampoo at the 99 cent store for $4.
Like, I mean, I know inflation is going up, but it's not that much.
It's not.
It's not, baby.
Why is the deep conditioner spray $14 in Target and locked up? And Pantene is in the same aisle and it's $4 and it is not.
It's just like, this is where stereotypes go. I can't even say go so far, because demeaning somebody into making them into a character is far, because then you're messing with somebody's, like, how they see themselves and, like, that. And that's, like, a whole group. And then also at the same time being like, also, you might, I'm gonna take your products too. Like, that's how much stereotypes, like, really form not just people but society in a way.
Yeah, stereotypes are rooted deep in capitalism, in, like, socially. Stereotypes are everywhere, grounded in our society.
Like, especially even in, like, movies and TV shows, you know, you always have that one black sidekick who's, like, loud and ghetto only for, like, just, like, the question. Only, like, to amplify it. Be like, oh, girl, I would never do that. Or, girl. Or, like, stuff like that. And it's just, like, we're a lot more than that. Like, I hope you guys know that that's... Black girls and black women are so much more than just being like that one, girl, you shouldn't do that, or girl, no. Like, we're, please, trust me, from black girl to y'all, we're so much more than that. We have so much more depth and empathy for each other and just character than just an girl.
And we're smart. We have motives. We have goals.
That's right.
And we do not want to throw hands all the time.
No.
I don't know where that comes from.
Not touch me.
please don't.
I will cry, so.
Yeah, I might not even fight back. I might just call the police.
Oh.
Yeah. Black people be scared of the police, not me.
Oh, not even one is crazy.
But that might be because I'm a woman, but that's a whole nother episode.
Yeah, that's just we'll get to that one in the next episode, y'all. But, yeah, that's just, wow. We asked you guys some questions on our Instagram. Go follow us at the_experience podcast. There's an underscore in between there, but it's okay. On Instagram, I'll put a little something here. Y'all will see it and follow us. And we asked some questions, and we'd love to see, like, your stories and your comments. One of our questions were... the stereotypes that you see as, like, a black woman. We only got two responses on this one, but one said that they are ghetto and uneducated.
Real.
That was an interesting stereotype that I think we both definitely know and we could get into. But we already talked about the ghetto part, but the uneducated part I feel like really resonates with me, because I had an IEP, like, all throughout, like, school and now, and I feel like that kind of went into it, because especially in middle school, there was a lot of, like, black kids in my school, and mostly the black girls or, like, the black guys, they would be seen as, like, they would also have an IEP, and it would be like, no, they need a lot of help, guys. Like, we really need to push for them. Like, I don't think they can read from this book. They need, like, an audible book. Like, somebody needs to read to them. And that, I feel like that really kind of stunted our, like, I guess us as a collective in that school. It was like, it kind of stunted our reading abilities in a way.
Right.
Because you're just getting something read aloud to you and you're not really reading. Like, you're not doing right. that. Well, now I've got to a point like, yes, guys, I can read. But it was just like the babying, but like babying not in a good way, babying in like a, I think they really need help. Like, they need our help.
Right.
Because they don't know for themselves. Like, we would literally get in trouble sometimes if we read from a book and not from, like, our little learning, like, reading thing.
Oh.
And I was like, they're like, you're not supposed to be reading from this. You're supposed to be reading from the computer. And it's like, I can read, guys. It's fine. But,
about the uneducated part, I don't have an experience like that. I did go to a predominantly person of color, all-girls school from kindergarten to eighth grade. Which, we'll get into that at another point in the episode, because it's not what you think it is. But I think it's a systemic thing, too, because the school that I'm in right now is definitely very diverse, but I think it's more so people of color than anything. And we're broke.
Oh, wow.
You know? And I think it's, like, it's just, like, rooted in the system. We don't have the money. Well, let me not, hold on. Rewind. Not we don't have the money. We're not given. We're not funded with the money in our school communities to have the same education as someone that is white or someone that goes to a private school on West 4th Street. You know? That got personal.
No, it's fine. I love it. Yeah. Oh, another one. You want to read that one?
I'll read it. Very interesting. Another response to our question on our Instagram. Someone said that black women love hair, stay in the house, and love to cook.
I feel like that gives the mammy stereotype, actually. Mm-hmm. That's, like, when I saw that, it just kind of flashed me to, like, just mammies.
Right.
Which, if you guys don't know what a mammy is, it's basically the stereotype that came up mostly right after slavery in the Jim Crow era. It was just, like, a black woman who, like, loved to serve her, like, masters or her, like, her bosses, basically, like, the white people that she worked for. She loved to cook. She loved to cook fried chicken. She had a headscarf, and she was like, oh, I love me some, like, da-da-da. Like, I love me this. I love me that. I love to cook for whoever and this and that, and I love to clean for my people. And it was this whole thing, and that kind of stereotype is still forced onto black women sometimes, but it's just right. To put it into words, it's because I feel like it's much more than that. Like, it's culture, because, you know, in the black community, African-American black, African black, or like Caribbean black, like, food is very popular in the black community.
Yeah, food is serious.
Yeah, like, all throughout. And that's how we show love and this and that. But then it could also be seen as a, oh, in the mammy stereotype of, like, black women always wanting to cook. And it's like, we're trying to uplift our culture and share something that we feel is very meaningful to us. Like, food. Like, Caribbean food, because, you know, we're both Caribbean. Like, Caribbean food, or, like, black American food, or African food. But it's also, like, we can't have fun because we're being put into, like, oh, like, that's a mammy, you know?
Yeah.
This is like, oh, my goodness. Yes, we tell. Whole nother realm.
Yeah, I agree with that 100%. I feel like that whole stereotype, it really, like, the first thing that rang in my head was, like, that thing where everyone's like, who do you serve first, your kids or your husband?
Oh, my goodness.
And that, I hate that question. But, that's just, like, that whole question is just, like, rooted in nonsense. Because it's, like, black women are meant to serve. I mean, those are two both very real stereotypes that are valid.
Yeah.
And comment if you have any other black stereotypes.
Yeah, we'll love to hear.
Let's have a conversation.
Comment down below or DM us on Instagram, and we'll put, like, those tags at the bottom. But I also think another stereotype that really goes on in, you know, the community is the over-sexualization of black women and girls. That, I feel like, well, we're girls, so we could definitely talk about that a lot, but that type of, I don't know if you say mentality, but I guess mentality,
mm-hmm.
is so detrimental to black girls and black women in general, no matter the age, because just because of how you look, we're already being penalized for how we look because we're black, but now we're being penalized because of how we look because of our body. Like, literally nothing. We have nothing.
Oppressed and fetishized. Can we have an in-between where we're just normal?
It feels so, like, isolating that
it is.
One, you go out into the world, you have all of this racism, microaggressions, all this stuff that you have to overcome, and then when you come home, or, like, when you're around people that you know and love, and you're in, like, family, whatever, it's, like, the hyper-over-sexualization, and be like, you're doing this, you're doing that, and it's like, but I'm not.
Yeah.
I'm just being me. I'm literally just living.
Yeah, I have to put so much thought into what I wear before I go around certain people. I have to think about the location, who's going to be there, whether it's family or not, because it'd be your own family. And I feel like we shouldn't have to do that as black girls.
Definitely. I feel like it's to the point of just, like, it's just, you're always having to, like, fight for something. And we were talking before this, actually, like, talking about, like, the word fast. Like, calling black girls fast.
Oh, disgusting. And it'd be children.
And it'd be, like, it would be little kids who literally wants to wear shorts and a tank top or whatever. It's like, oh, you're fast for wearing certain things. You're fast for nail polish. Like, literally, I was in lots of wear red nail polish to, like, now. Like, and still, it's iffy. Like, I can't even, it's like, I'd rather not because I don't want to, like, upset anybody. Or what else is
these certain fast? Styles of dancing that black girls did was fast. Even if it's cultural.
Yeah.
You're fast.
Definitely.
Everything is fast. There's a lot of things that can be called fast by black people.
Yeah. And, like, for those who don't know, like, fast means just, like, you're going up fast. I guess that's like, what it means.
Like, kind of like you're, I hate to say it, kind of like you're asking for it.
Yeah.
Like, you're being very promiscuous.
Yeah.
Even though it's used a lot with children.
You'd be like, oh, she acting fast or something like that. And it's just like, no.
Not really.
I'm just trying to live.
And you never hear that about white people. Like, white people be having boyfriends, girlfriends in the fourth grade. Nobody would ever bat an eye.
It's never looked at, like, for another time. It's always like, oh, that's so cute, whatever. But, like, when a black girl tries to do it, it's like, oh, no.
She's fast.
And it's like, that's, like, the difference of growing up. Because I definitely saw that, especially in my elementary school. Because every time in elementary school where I wanted to be like, oh, yeah, I had a crush, I felt like I couldn't say it because they'd be like, ugh. I feel like the other kids' perspective was like, you're not supposed to have a boyfriend or, like,
yeah,
a crush or whatever. But they would have crushes every single day, and it was fine, and it was cute. But so, like, I never expressed that, and I feel like that carries out to now where I'm just like, yeah, no, like, I'm just going to keep my comments about that to myself. Like, I'm not telling anybody. Because right. It's like, we're not allowed to be vulnerable at all. There's no, like, vulnerability, and when that does happen, it's seen as being fast, or it's seen as being, like, you're straying away from being ghetto. Like, you're supposed to be ghetto. Stay in this box. Don't veer off and try to be vulnerable and really have a moment with me. You're supposed to stay on this track, be ghetto, be loud, and that's all I want you to be. And it's like, wow, you can't live.
That's not me, bro.
I try to not put that stereotype every day, but it comes back to me, and you just get to the point where you're tired, and you're just like, you know what?
It's tiring.
Okay, I'm just gonna let it ride, and hopefully I'll find my peace. But I try not to let it, like, bother me to a point, you know?
Yeah.
And I don't know, I feel like as a black girl, you have to act a certain way, like how you're saying whitewash. Like, sometimes you have to act like that, or act really, like, opposite from yourself to get attention.
Yeah.
And it's like, you're never gonna be yourself ever to get attention from anybody. To, like, from a guy, it was like, oh no, like, you have to, I don't like your hair, or, like, I don't like how she acts, like, she's too loud and ghetto. But if you get, like, quote unquote, the whitewashed black girl, then they probably go more for that, you know?
Yeah.
Like,
that's it. It's like, no matter, like, who you're around, you have to, like, code switch in some shape, way, or form. It's like, when I'm with the girls at school that would say that, like, I'm whitewashed or too nice or whatever, it's like, now I feel like I have to use more AAVE and more, like, more slang, and I have to speak a certain way, when it's like, that's not how I talk in real life. That's just, yeah, like, I just wasn't raised in that environment, and that's just not how I speak.
Yeah.
And I definitely, then it's like, oh. And then it's like, when I'm around other people, I can't be as funny as I am. It's like, I have to, if I was in a room full of white men, then I wouldn't act like myself either.
Right.
So either way, it's kind of like, not yourself.
I definitely do feel that. And it's just like, you can't, literally, what I've been saying this whole thing, you can't do anything.
You cannot escape, you cannot come out. You
cannot. But I also feel like the lack of support, that goes into like the lack of support in the black community. There's not enough. I feel like we could say to the birds sing that we're for black people, we're by black people, that we do this and that. But when it really comes down to it, black women and black girls don't feel protected.
That was deep.
We don't.
Who's protecting us, though?
Because some, I don't want to generalize it, because I feel like we're going to get comments like, no, but I, like,
I mean, I, yeah, we're not discrediting the black girls out there that are like, I love my sisters, because we love you too.
Right.
But there's not enough of that.
We don't get that from, like, black women and black men. Like, what we were just talking about, it could be, like, your own girlfriends or your own mothers or aunts or cousins being like, no, you're being too fast, or blaming it on you that something has happened to you. And then also turn around and be the men saying the same thing. So you're getting it from both angles, and then you don't feel supported. And then you don't feel the need, not feel the need, but just like, don't feel like you could be vulnerable. Mm-hmm. And so the shell is created. And then you get that shell, you have that shell on you, and then you're seen as the angry black woman. So,
oh, it, gosh,
it goes, I'm saying, listen, no escape, to me. Yo. I'm going to get closer to the mic and listen to me. Because it's a cycle. It's a full cycle that goes and continues and continues. And this is where the lack of support comes from. And this is exactly where black girls don't feel like they're heard. Like, literally, there's so many, I don't know if you guys see on, like, your Instagram stories, but every other story, some, like, there's girls being missing and people are putting posters of them. There's majority POC girls, but a lot of them are black girls, and nobody really talks about them. You see the people who post them, but it's never like supported that much. Mm-hmm. Until something catastrophically big happens, support is never there.
Yeah,
it's only the little things when you get some people here, some people there, but it's never like an actual thing that's there and present that people feel like they could go to somebody. Let me get close to this mic, y'all. And listen up to what I just said.
It's getting real in here, y'all.
Rewind what I just said and listen to it again.
Playback. And process it.
Pause. And go back.
Think about it.
Please. Because what I'm saying right here is very important. So, we also have another question that we asked on our Instagram. Go check us out, please. Where we asked, actually, have you ever been over-sexualized because of your race? And share, basically. A lot of people, we got a lot of agreements. A lot of people were saying yes and just how they feel uncomfortable. But there's one right here. I'm going to just read it real quick. Where it says, yes, I've been followed many times, and sometimes I wouldn't know without my friends being there. So, we are being followed, guys.
Relatable. So relatable.
Followed, stalked, watched.
Catcalled, all of the above.
We are in NYC. We are scared. It's a scary time, I would say.
It really is.
It's scary.
It gets very scary out here.
And the thing is, I was talking to my friends about this, like, it doesn't even matter what you wear, because I feel like that's always the first question that people ask is like, oh, what were you wearing? But like, you could wear the bummiest of bummies outfits. That's just... Hey guys, so as you've seen, the video has cut. We were recording it and it was getting real deep in the conversation.
It was getting good.
Yeah, but the camera literally cut.
Camera's off.
But it's gonna be unfound footage. We don't know what we talked about. You don't know what we talked about. But just know it was a riveting conversation. And thank you for listening to our first episode.
We'll see you next time. Stay tuned for the next episode of the Experience Podcast. Make sure you follow us on Instagram and TikTok.
We'll put it right here. Okay, bye.